But now I'd like to introduce our second speaker, Janet Iwasa, who's coming to us from the University of Utah. Janet, take it away.
Thank you so much. I will share my screen and hopefully you guys can all see that. My name is Janet Iwasa. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Biochemistry at the University of Utah. You can see Utah's background behind me here. So my lab specializes in visualization, in particular in animation of molecular processes. And I'm really happy to have this opportunity to talk to you about a visualization that's focused on the SARS-CoV-2 life cycle. So one of the major goals of this project is to create a detailed animation of the SARS-CoV-2 life cycle based on the latest findings from the scientific community. So this is an illustration of the viral life cycle that was made by a postdoctoral fellow in my lab, Anne Liu. And it shows the basic process of the life cycle. Starting with the upper left, you can see viral entry, followed by translation of viral RNAs that are made into proteins, and then the formation of these interesting structures called double membrane vesicles in the middle, and that's where the viral RNAs are copied. And then on the right, we see the formation of new viruses that are then released from the cell. So to talk a little bit about our process, to create these animations, we start by consulting with SARS-CoV-2 experts from around the world, and then we develop these visual storyboards that are really based on our conversations with these experts. So one thing that's really important to note is that there's still a lot that we don't yet understand about SARS-CoV-2, and that these animations are really based on the current hypotheses that were available at the time that we made these animations. So I'm just gonna go ahead and play the video. But first, I do want to say that, you know, what I'm showing today is actually a pretty truncated version of the full-length animation, and that we really encourage you to check out the full animation on the link shown below. It's at animationlab.utah.edu/cova. All right, so I'm going to play this. So the first part of the animation focuses on sort of the anatomy of the virus, especially on the spike protein, which is shown in teal, kind of wiggling around there on the surface. Inside of the virus, we have the RNA, the viral RNA that's wrapped around nucleocapsid protein that's shown in gray. The next part of the animation focuses on how the virus gets in. So we can see these proteins on the respiratory cell surface, which is shown at the bottom. We have these purple proteins called ACE2 that are able to bind to the spike protein on the virus, which is shown here again in teal. So ACE2 binding is thought to kind of lock the spike protein in a specific kind of shape that then enables it to get opened, to stay in this open position. Proteases called TMPRSS2 then kind of cut away parts of the spike protein and they kind of fall away. And that allows the spike protein to undergo a series of conformational changes. So the first one, it kind of acts like a harpoon. It injects itself into the membrane of the cell and then it folds back on itself, which really allows the membrane of the virus to fuse with the membrane of the cell. At this point, basically the nucleocapsid, the RNA genome, is able to enter the cell. The next stage shows early translation. So soon after nucleocapsid entry, ribosomes are recruited to the viral RNA and they start translating viral proteins. These proteins are called non-structural proteins, or NSPs, and they're initially translated as a long chain of proteins. They generally, these proteins have a large range of functions. So some of the NSP genes encode proteases that can cut the NSPs apart, and that's necessary for their function. Others form a polymerase, which is shown in the next segment of the animation, and others have yet undiscovered functions. So some of these NSPs, especially kind of showing going to the next segment, are thought to mediate these kind of changes in the endoplasmic reticulum membrane that allows for the formation of the double membrane vesicles. So you can see the double membrane vesicles forming here and encapsulating some of the viral RNA within them. And these DMVs are thought to be a really important way that the virus is able to evade the cell's innate immunity mechanisms. So next up, we have a pretty short 2D animation that describes the way that SARS-CoV-2 makes subgenomic mRNAs that encode structural proteins, including proteins like spike proteins, the things kind of you saw in the initial animation. So what happens within the DMVs? So within the DMVs, we have these replication transcription complex, which is a key complex that's responsible for producing viral RNAs. And they're made up of a number of different NSPs. So the replication transcription complex includes an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase and also a helicase that's capable of unwinding double-stranded RNA. And this is really responsible for making mRNAs of the structural proteins that can go on to be made into proteins, and as well as copies of the full-length genome that then get packaged into new viruses. So one thing to note is that we're still working on the final part of the life cycle that will show how basically viruses are being produced in the cells and then how they egress. So again, that was just a pretty truncated version of the full length animation, and we really would love it if more people kind of checked out the full animation on this website. The second part of this project focuses on creating annotation and commenting software, and this really enables us to describe the data that we use to create the animation, and it also allows the community to comment and to ask questions and critique the hypotheses that we depict in this animation. So this is a snapshot of what that tool looks like. It's a web-based tool, totally free to use. You can check it out right now on the website. So you can see the animation in the center there. You can play the animation, and on the left side, there are annotations, so what kind of papers did we use, what structures did we use to create this animation, and on the right side are comments and questions from the community. So to show you what that looks like here, I'm playing the animation, I pause it, you can mouse over any of the structures you see in the animation to figure out what those proteins are, and then if you click on them, you can see the annotations that are associated with that structure on the left side. And there's additional sort of data visualization tools below it. So we think, as molecular animators, we think that this type of tool is really important, especially for projects like this, where there's a lot of current research happening. And there's a lot of things that we think we understand well about how the virus works, but there are also a lot of things that are still quite uncertain. So we're hoping that the animation combined with the annotation and commenting tool will really allow the community to engage in fruitful discourse about, you know, what happens during the SARS-CoV-2 life cycle, and to better understand whether we're coming to a consensus about how the virus works. So again, we really would love to see more comments and questions from the community, and it will also be the basis on which we may make future revisions for the animation. And with that, that is the end of my presentation. I wanted to give thanks to my lab members, particularly to Anne Liu and Margot Rigge, who helped me animate the viral life cycle, and to our collaborators, Mariah Meyer and Jen Rogers, who are involved in creating the annotation software.